we're the richest and most technologically advanced society in human history, and yet we're hurtling towards disaster, and relief is not in sight. The question is, will we continue our current path or look for a new paradigm for climate action? We may look back with nostalgia and wistfulness in a decade or two at how cool temperatures were this week compared to what they'll be in a decade or two.
And as we gather here today, we're actually quite lucky because there was a serious heat wave for the last 4 or 5 days. And when we were looking, me and Herb were looking about 10 days ago at the long-term forecast, and it looked like it was going to be 33°C in London today. We were really worried that this is going to be very stuffy. But today we're very lucky that we've got some westerlies have come in and it's cooled down. But it's been extraordinary over the last 7 days, actually, over Europe and the UK, where we've seen temperature anomalies of up to 12°C higher than normal, which is just incredible. And there's latest science just out recently, they're just published that England is actually, for 32°C, it's currently 100 times more likely to hit 32°C because of climate change. So that's just incredible stats, and it just shows you how important conversations like today really are. So we'll begin today with a focused discussion. We're going to look at climate strategies with Herb Simmens, and then we're going to hear from Dr. Tao on his research on sustainable cooling and engineering. And then we'll have the brilliant Professor Steve Keen hopefully tell us how we all got into this mess in the first place. So each speaker brings a unique and essential perspective. And will offer a comprehensive view of where we are, what can be done, and how we move forward. So that being said, it's my great pleasure to introduce the first speaker today, Herb Simmens. Herb is a longtime climate leader. He co-led the effort that saw Montgomery County become the first US jurisdiction to declare a climate emergency in 2017. He is the author of A Climate Vocabulary of the Future, described by author Kim Stanley Robinson as a science poem, an inspiration, and a prophecy. Herb also co-founded the Healthy Planet Action Coalition, an international group of scientists and others working to restore a safe and healthy climate. He's also the host of the Climate Emergency Forum on YouTube with Paul Beckwith and Peter Carter. Today, Herb will present how the climate triad can restore a safe and healthy climate. Herb will also be our moderator for the other sessions today also. After Herb's talk, we'll have a little bit of time for a short Q&A with myself moderating that, so please prepare any questions for that so we can get through that quickly. So with that being said, please join me in welcoming Herb Simmens.
Thanks, Peter. And it's a pleasure to be here in London, in general, and in particular at the London Foundling Museum, which is a historic institution started hundreds of years ago to take care of children in need at what was a hospital right here. And we're in a room that's called the Picture Gallery, and those of you who are watching won't be surprised at that name, because we have some imposing photos behind us, or portraits rather, including the portrait in the center is of a doctor who actually was the physician for Sir Isaac Newton. So that sort of humbles me. And they're probably looking down on us, or up at us, whatever, wherever they may be right now, wondering what in the world we are doing or not doing to resolve the climate crisis. We're the richest and most technologically advanced society in human history, and yet we're hurtling towards disaster, and relief is not in sight. The question is, will we continue our current path or look for a new paradigm for climate action? We may look back with nostalgia and wistfulness in a decade or two at how cool temperatures were this week compared to what they'll be in a decade or two. Why hasn't humanity responded, even as we have the knowledge, the resources, the means, and the motivation to do so? One of the reasons, perhaps the main reason, is that we have conceptualized the climate problem too narrowly. Later today, Steve Keen will talk about how economists have also misconceptualized the climate problem with disastrous consequences. But it's not just economists. For the past 30 years, the climate elites have acted as if all we have in our toolbox is the hammer of emission reductions. Yet temperatures and impacts we're experiencing are from the legacy atmospheric greenhouse gases, primarily but not exclusively carbon dioxide. It is the accumulated stock of these gases, or metaphorically, the thickness of the greenhouse gas blanket above us, that creates the havoc and the climate problem. All emission reductions, no matter how essential, can achieve is slowing the increase in the thickness of this suffocating greenhouse gas blankets, meaning that temperatures will continue to increase for decades as long as we focus solely on emission reductions alone, or what I call ERA, emission reductions alone, because it does not deal with the stock of CO2 in the atmosphere. And even if the world is successful in the coming decades in eliminating emission reductions, our gargantuan and unprecedented task that we are much further away from today than we were 30 years when we started, because of the lengthy time that carbon dioxide remains in the atmosphere, doing so will only slow and potentially stop the increase in temperatures that are already too high and will be sharply higher in the coming decades there. And of course, we all know they're too high based upon everything that's around us. We also have this additional problem that overlaps with climate, and that is the ecological crisis, which is killing species and life on Earth so fast that I label it in my book a quote-unquote biotic genocide that faces humanity. So we need a shared toolbox to deal with what I call the bioclimactic problem, not just the climate problem, but the bio problem as well there. I encourage you to speak this way as well. We've even had to invent a new vocabulary to describe some of these extreme phenomena. Marine heat waves, flash droughts, atmospheric rivers, drunken trees, sunny day flooding, clean air turbulence, derechos, methane craters, ice quakes, and furnace winds. What new words and terms will we be required to create next year? In addition, glacial and sea ice is melting at current temperatures and has been melting for decades there, and ecosystems are collapsing all around us there. And this will continue, if not accelerate, and this is important, even if emission reductions are eliminated. This will continue for centuries. That's right, for centuries there, even with emission reductions being eliminated. In other words, reaching net zero by mid-century or even sooner does not and indeed cannot solve the climate crisis. You won't hear that very often. I wish it was more widely known. So if all we have is the hammer of emission reductions, we're progressing towards a future that none of us here would want to live in, and none of us or our kids or grandkids should have to live in. So a number of us, more and more, but still way too few, are calling for the whole toolbox to be taken out of the shed and urgently employed to repair our climate. Then these tools are, yes, emission reductions. They absolutely need to be accelerated. There's lots of ways for that to happen. And many of the programs here at the London Climate Week this week are focusing exclusively on that one particular tool. But we also need to scale up all possible approaches for removing carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, as daunting as a task that is. It's actually, some have estimated, equivalent to recreating the scale of the entire infrastructure of the fossil fuel industry to pull out the excess CO2 that's in the atmosphere that's causing the climate crisis there. Some of the ways, and no doubt others will be created or discovered, to pull CO2 out of the atmosphere include the weathering of rocks, directly capturing CO2 from the air by machines, massive ecosystem restoration, and many more, though. Most urgently, however, and most controversially, yes, we need to find ways, indeed we have already found some, to test and deploy a suite of approaches that can directly cool the climate. So controversial is this idea of directly cooling the climate, some have called it geoengineering, solar radiation management, sunshine reflection, there's about a dozen different terms for it, that this very day, in 2 hours, give or take, there, the Parliament, not far from here, will be debating at Westminster Hall whether to prohibit solar radiation management and whether to prohibit even pulling CO2 out of the atmosphere. That's right, they will be having a debate at 4:30 today, British summertime, and I encourage you, after you've had the drinks and chats here, maybe to wander over. I hope to go to watch some of that debate there. So it's kind of ironic and maybe a little tragic that these two things are happening the same day. I don't mean to presume that what's happening here is just as important as in Parliament, but I am presuming that what I'm saying here and what we were all saying here is a critically important message we need to hear. The techniques for removing, for cooling the planet directly include what's called stratospheric aerosol injection, which mimics a volcanic eruption, marine cloud brightening, thinning cirrus clouds in a variety of ways to increase the reflectivity of surfaces, including the specially designed mirrors, as MEER and Yay will be talking about in the rest of this program. So far, these techniques, based upon hundreds of computer and other simulations, have not been shown to have any fatal flaws. Critics of direct cooling often portray it as presenting impossible to estimate risks, immense shocks of prematurely terminated, the hazard of distracting us from slowing emission reductions, and perhaps the most challenging questions of how, when, and by whom to govern the research, development, deployment, and monitoring of cooling proper portfolios. In other words, who controls the thermostat? Big question. But in a world where only, and I repeat, only directly cooling the climate has the potential to stabilize and lower temperatures in years rather than in many decades, these criticisms should not be seen as reasons to stop the one approach that many of us believe could save humanity and the natural world, but as legitimate challenges that our best minds need to focus on to minimize or overcome. All three, emission reductions, large-scale atmospheric carbon removal, and direct cooling of the climate through sunshine reflection and other means, are what I have labeled the climate triad, all three. They're all essential, urgent, and must be done in a coordinated and integrated fashion based upon the best science and technology. They must be done with sufficient participation, particularly by those countries, individuals, and groups that are most affected and often, unfortunately, the least influential in world politics, the global south and many others who are disadvantaged in the global north. It's a matter both of spatial equity and intergenerational equity, as our generation, sadly, has preempted or is in the process of preempting the future of every subsequent generation to be born on this planet, as well as every generation of life, except perhaps maybe jellyfish and cockroaches and the life and the like. From a human rights perspective, what right do we, the current inhabitants of this planet, have to prevent the deployment of a means that can likely guarantee a healthier and safer climate than would otherwise exist in the coming decades? And it must be done urgently because of what is called a procrastination penalty. Each day we wait, the problem gets steeper. Climate snowballs, or perhaps we should say fireballs, are beginning to tip over at the top of the mountain. And if we don't stop them soon, they'll be too fast and too out of control. Humanity also needs what I call climate adaptation, adaptation that resiliently changes form to ride the waves of climate change the way a good surfer brilliantly adapts to ocean waves. So that's the recipe. Let us tell policymakers and climate-aware activists that they need to dip deeper into their toolbox and not rule out any tool as out of order, as being discussed in Parliament in an hour. And so we want to encourage each of you to become, if you're not already, what I would call a climatrarian and a planetarian. Think boldly out of the box and think at the planetary scale, at the local scale. We are facing what I call a one-generational challenge to restore our bioclimate. I hope you, your friends, and colleagues will join that one-generational challenge. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Herb, for that very enlightening, but short talking. I can't believe they're having a debate about not trying to turn down the temperature slightly. I didn't know about that. So anyway, listen, we've only got a very short period of time. So if we've got some questions, have we got any questions? I'd rather people ask questions they want from the audience. If you put your hand up, we can bring a microphone.
You talk about global equity. Shouldn't there be something in there about lifestyle changes for the 0.1% or the 1%? What are we prepared to give up in the global north or the first world to let the third world have a better life? And if you saw the pictures of that town, perhaps in Africa somewhere, you know, they may want an EV. They may want a 300-mile-an-hour train. So shouldn't there be something there about what we are prepared to give up to give other people a better life?
The question is, as I understand it, should we be prepared to give up some of what we have from an equity point of view so that others in the global south and elsewhere can have what we take for granted? And I guess I would say that what we should be prepared to give up is the incredible waste of what our society produces. The fact that people, I don't know what they're called here in the United States, they're called the SUV, suburban utility vehicles, these monster vehicles. I think in London they're called Chelsea tractors, as I understand, that you know, you get in your Chelsea tractor, or in the United States in your SUV, and you drive 1 kilometer to the convenience store to buy a loaf of bread. I mean, you know, that you multiply that by a billion times a year and give examples of hundreds of other examples like that. That's what we need to give up. Not decent living standards, but the capitalist waste, and doing so will have enormous benefits, I think, for our life and health here in the global north, and give the opportunity for those in the global south to acquire some of the life-saving, comfortable activities that are essential.
I've just got one question, Herb, before we'll probably have to move on after this. In terms of carbon dioxide removal, I mean, you said there, and I've heard this myself as well, you would need the infrastructure probably of all the fossil fuel infrastructure that's already been built in the world to do that. So how feasible really is that? I mean, if you're talking about one third of the US need to be covered in kind of 3D infrastructure, and that's why I always back 2D infrastructure, because it's much easier, but that's an incredible amount of energy it would need to be even to do that.
Yeah, I think it would take a planetary world war scale mobilization to do that. It's certainly physically possible to do that. It's economically possible in the sense that during World War II, I mean, this country here where we're sitting in the US, we spend as much as 40% of our GDP on wars. So probably over one generation, as I pointed out, we could do that. There's no we don't know whether there are physical constraints, because there's still additional research. But assuming that the physical constraints can be overcome, it can be done. The likelihood of it happening when we're going the opposite way is close to zero right now. And that's one of the reasons why direct cooling of the climate is so attractive a proposition, because it would not take anywhere near the amount of resources, a tiny amount of resources in the billions of pounds and dollars, not the trillions, and could be done in years and not decades. But ultimately, we need to do all three.